Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for our time together. Thank you that you do such an amazing job loving us and ministering to us. Thank you that your presence is here. And thank you, Lord, that we have your life and your strength and your peace on the inside of us. And Father, we thank you tonight for the Holy Spirit, the great teacher. And we thank you for the Word of God. And we believe that you're going to minister to us. We open our hearts, our ears, and we ask you to help us to receive and absorb fully all that you have for us tonight. And Father, we thank you for changing lives, transforming lives. Father, we thank you that tonight is going to be a life-changing event for many, many people here tonight. And Lord, thank you for your goodness toward us, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. You can go ahead and be seated. Pastor Dan, thanks for your kind words. I think about this church, and Paul said about one of the churches, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. And I do think of you periodically, and just am so thankful for what you're doing here. And I'm thankful that God put you here because of his desire that the Inland Empire, what? Shall be saved. And I get excited thinking about what is going on here. I thank God for the amazing legacy that Pastor Jim and Deborah have established here. And thank God for the leadership, Pastor Dan and Luke, that are, you know, still carrying on such a great, great, amazing work here. And it's one of the highlights of my year to be here. And so thanks for the privilege. I want to just take a minute and show you a couple pictures. I asked Pastor Dan, I said, are the flags new? And you mentioned you just had a missions conference, is that right? And so I didn't know that, but I wanted to go ahead and share with you a couple pictures of some of the fun places that Lisa and I have gotten to go to in the last year or so. The first picture, that is from Moscow, Russia. Those are believers in Moscow at Good News Church. Many of you have heard of Pastor Rick Renner, and he's a dear friend, and they've been over there in the former Soviet Union for, I don't know, 25 years or something, maybe close to 30 now. But amazing church there. That is a relatively new building that they are in. They moved into it about maybe close to a year and a half ago. $18 million building that they moved into debt-free because God's so good. And that was my sixth trip to Moscow to preach there. And they've just had amazing progress. They have three services like that every weekend. And when they did their grand opening, of course, this is in Moscow, and Vladimir Putin sent four of his top government officials to congratulate the church, celebrate, you know, with them on their grand opening. And Rick said he was really blown away because all four of these top government officials from Putin's administration got up, greeted the people, shared scripture, and talked about what Jesus meant to them. And I think that's pretty awesome. While we were there, the next slide, we got to see four of our books in the Russian language, and that was really fun to see that, and we got to do a book signing and things like that, and it's just kind of neat to know those are being used across Russia and Ukraine and several of the places over there. The next picture is from Russia. This was all last May. From Russia, we went to Switzerland, and this is Geneva, and these are all French-speaking Bible school students, part of Rhema Geneva, and they have schools not only in Geneva, but also Nice, France. They just started in Paris. There's some friends of theirs that have started a French-speaking Bible school in Quebec, Canada, and together, the Quebec and the Nice school started a school in Haiti, which is French-speaking, and all these people and the staff, the leaders, the students, they believe that God wants them to start a Bible school in every French-speaking nation of the world, and you know, they're just acting like they're supposed to do it, and they're acting like the Great Commission is true, and they're just, you know, doing it and doing a great, great work. The next picture was a little bit later in the year last year. I think that was September. I got to preach at a pastor's conference there in Brazil. And man, Brazil is really having revival. I noticed the Brazilian flag up there. The group that we're with, they've started more than 100 Bible schools in Brazil, including they're now starting them in prisons, which is great. The government is not just allowing them, but pleading with them, please start your Bible schools in our prisons. And so it's just awesome what's going on down there in Brazil. God's doing amazing things. And then the next picture is something that I'm really thrilled about. We just funded four of our books going into Arabic. And these four books, that's Grace on the left end and Life After Death in the left, second left. And then the gold is Qualified. And then In Search of Timothy is the green. And these are four of our books that are being translated into Arabic as we speak. And they are, it's being done in Egypt. They're going to be going all throughout the Middle East and all across Northern Africa into Bible schools and pastors and different things like that. So, we're just thankful, you know, to be able to serve God, and there's no place we enjoy more than the Rock Church. We just absolutely love being with you. And so I want to talk to you tonight about what may be kind of a funny topic to talk about, but I want to talk about pain, and I want to talk about it from a really positive standpoint. Nobody likes pain. Nobody wants pain. But I want to talk about transforming your pain into purpose. Transforming your pain into purpose. Because we have a God who is a God of redemption. The reason that we can come together at a place like this, at a time like this, and really rejoice and celebrate and find encouragement is because God is a God who has turned our lives around. We were headed for destruction. We were lost on our way to hell. We were separated from God. We were without hope. And how many of you are so thankful that God sent Jesus to the earth? And Jesus took all the sin and the shame and the guilt and the condemnation and everything that's associated with separation from God. Jesus took that upon Himself on the cross. And He took our sorrow so we could have His freedom. He took our death so that we could have His life. And because of what Jesus did as our substitute, we now have the privilege of being the children of God. And when we accept Him as our Lord and Savior, we get what the Bible calls the new birth. We get new life. And the Bible is a book of redemption. It's about how God just, He turns around the worst situations. And what the enemy intended for evil against us, God is able to turn around for good and bring good out of it. And so, you know, the story of the Bible is a story of redemption. And within that story of redemption, we have this consistent, steady theme of all the people in the Bible. If it gives enough detail, it talks about some of the pain they went through in life. And I think it's pretty safe to say that nobody goes through life unscathed. Nobody goes through life without experiencing some of the hardships, challenges, difficulties, you know, whether they're self-inflicted. How many of us have made decisions that our own self, we brought pain into our own life? How many of us have had somebody else bring some pain into our life? How many of us have just experienced pain because we just live in a fallen world? So the question is not, are we going to experience pain? The question is, how are we going to process the pain? If we don't process the pain by inviting God in, turning the situation over to God, releasing the internal turmoil of you know, resentment and unforgiveness, if we don't process the pain by turning it over to God, that pain can just fester on the inside of us, and we can end up with cesspools of toxin and poison on the inside of us. But if we will learn how to process the pain, and I like this term, how to transform our pain by God's help, then what was an area of pain in our life, what was an area of grief and woundedness can be so affected and so touched by the grace of God and the Spirit of God that instead of a pool of poison, we have a reservoir of grace. And not only do we experience healing from the woundedness and the pain, but then here's what happens when transformation has really taken place. We don't just get healed from the pain, but we become agents of healing toward others. And that's the difference between transforming your pain with God's help, with transforming your pain into purpose, as opposed to just letting that pain fester on the inside of you for who knows how long, and then perhaps even transmitting the pain to other people. God calls us to be transformed people of His healing, not people who just transmit the same pain that we've been afflicted with. And you know, like I said, the story of the Bible is full of people who've experienced and did experience horrific pain in their life. You know, Joseph, stop and think about him. Joseph was betrayed by his brothers because they were jealous of him. They sold him into slavery. He ends up as a slave in a foreign land. There's a lie told about him, and even though he did everything right, he's put into prison. He's forgotten in prison. Just, you know, it was just a bad decade for Joseph. Just nothing went right. And he experienced this horrific, what had to be incredible sense of rejection and betrayal and being forgotten and being disrespected. You know, it had to be a source of pain in his life. But Joseph, he knew something about God. And he just kept himself before God. He kept himself free from the bitterness and the resentment and the unforgiveness. And years later, when he encountered his brothers, and now Joseph is the prime minister of Egypt, and all he had to do was say, off with their heads, and it would have been payback, it would have been revenge. Joseph says, guys, he said, what you intended for evil against me, God has turned it around for good. And Joseph was able to transform his pain into purpose. And the story of the Bible is just character after character after character that the enemy brought all that he could against them. And one thing that we need to understand is God is not the source of our pain. God is the source of our healing. God is the source of blessing. Jesus said, the thief only comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. And yet the truth of the matter is we live in a fallen world. We live around a whole bunch of fallen people. And sometimes we are affected by these things. One Bible character that experienced incredible pain is the Apostle Paul, the guy that wrote, you know, probably half the books of the New Testament. And Paul said this in 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 4. I want you to listen to what he said. He said, God is the one who comforts us, not the one who afflicts us. How many people have been turned off by God, about God, because they thought He was the author of their problems? And I want you to know, God is not the author of your problem. God is the author of your solution. God's the author of your help. He's the author of our comfort. God is the one who comforts us in all our tribulation. So no matter what tribulation you're going through, God is there to comfort. He comforts us in all our tribulation so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation or comfort also abounds through Christ. And I just absolutely love that, because what we see is that Paul not only received comfort from God, but his mentality was such that once he received comfort, consolation, hope, help, strength from God, he realized that it was now his job not just to be a recipient of that comfort, but to become a distributor of that comfort. One of the best ways to indicate just how healed you are from some of the different pains of life is to ask the question, how much am I helping other people who have gone through or are going through what I went through? Because that's really one of the key indicators, is that we've taken the grace that God has given us to help us through our difficult situation, and we now have such an appreciation for God that we are not just sitting on that blessing, but we are taking that blessing and we're sharing it with others. We're finding other people that are going through the despair, the insecurity, the inferiority, the rejection, the betrayal, all of those things, and we're giving them the same hope that God gave us. We're giving them the same comfort that God gave us. You know, because there's so many different kinds of pain that people go through in life. I made a list, and I don't want anybody to get depressed while I read this, but, you know, the pain of inferiority and insecurity, the pain of a struggling or broken marriage or other relationship, the pain of a wayward child, the pain of an emotional challenge, the pain of addiction or addictive tendencies, the pain of loss, the pain of abuse, the pain of loneliness, of rejection, betrayal, the pain of failure, disappointment, regret, the pain of sickness and disease, the pain of financial pressure, the pain of other people's criticisms and judgments. And that's about all I want to read, because this sermon is not intended to look like, how many of you remember the old theme from the song Hee Haw? Anybody remember that? There was a song that they sang with the sorriest tone and the most down in the mouth, you know, attitude, gloom, despair, agony on me, deep, dark depression, excessive misery. If it weren't for bad luck, I'd have no luck at all. Gloom, despair, and agony on me. That's not what this sermon is about. We're talking about pain being transformed and finding divine purpose to have the attitude of Joseph, to take what the enemy meant for evil and turn it into good, to make sure that we end up in life not with a pool of poison on the inside, but a reservoir of grace, not just for us to partake of, but for us to have a flow out of our life so that we can comfort others with the comfort with which we have been comforted by God. Amen. Let me share with you a story that, you know, is real close to home. When my wife and I got married, we were married in 1979, and my wife and I both grew up in Indiana. We immediately moved. Within the week, we were out in Oklahoma, some 750 miles away, and 20-year-olds out there to attend Bible school. First time that, you know, we'd been that far away from home by a long stretch. And an older, sweet couple in the church, my wife and I were janitors in the church while we were going to Bible school, an older, well, and I say older now, they were probably 50. And now that doesn't seem old at all, but when you're 20, you know, I mean, that's ancient when you're 20. And so this couple was probably 50-ish or something like that, and he was a bit older than she was, but they didn't have any kids of their own. They had married a little bit later in life, and they just kind of adopted Lisa and I. And they were so kind. They were Sunday school teachers at the church, and they would invite us up to their home for dinner and just have a good home-cooked meal and just be able to sit in an actual house. And you know, it's just so nice. They were just kind of like a mom and a dad to us. And long story short, we maintained a good relationship with them over the years. And maybe 8-10 years ago, he passed away. His name was Claude, and he passed away, his wife, they'd been partners for a few decades, so it was tough on her to lose her husband that way. But one of the books, we gave her a copy of one of our books called Life After Death, Rediscovering Life After the Loss of a Loved One. It deals helping people find comfort when they've lost a loved one. And we just gave it to her because we loved her, and it was just something, a resource we had. And she called us a few months later, and she told us, man, that book has really helped me. It's helped me remember to keep my focus on heaven and on the comfort of the Holy Spirit. And she just said, it's helping me so much. She said, do you think I could get a couple copies? I'm thinking of some other people I know, their husband has died, or they've lost a loved one, and I just kind of like to give them a copy too. And so we got her a few copies, and then she started, could I get some more copies? And she just started this, and she just had it on her heart. This is an area of my life where I've had great pain, losing my husband, and God has comforted me. And one of the tools that God used was that book. And so she wanted to begin to give that book. See, she wanted to become, one person called it being a wounded healer, where you don't, you face a painful experience, you experience some pain or a wound, but instead of that driving you into isolation and feeling ashamed and getting just in a corner somewhere, you take that pain that's very real and you give it to God, and you invite God to help you, and you the Holy Spirit ministers to you, and the Scriptures comfort you, and you not only receive help from God, but then you become a person who reaches out to help others. Like what Paul said, the God who comforts us in all our tribulation so that we can comfort others who are in any trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. We're talking about getting your pain transformed. So long story short, in these years that have gone by, Carolyn, and we give her a big discount, you'll understand why, Carolyn had just purchased her 650th copy of that book. She buys them 20 at a time. And she carries them in her purse. And she'll carry, and she'll go to Walmart, and she's never met a stranger, and she'll see somebody, and how are you doing? They're in line to check out, and that person, well, I'm not good. So-and-so just died. And she'll say, well, let me buy you a cup of coffee. And man, she's just looking for opportunities to minister, and that's just a tool she uses. You don't have to use any particular tool, but I think it's an amazing model, though, to see somebody who, because they so appreciate how God helped them through that situation, they want to follow what Jesus taught when Jesus said, freely you have received, freely give. And when you adopt that mentality, that's when you become, I don't like the term wounded, I like the term a healed healer. But you've been through it. You've been through the valley, and God's brought you out, and now you want to help other people through that kind of situation. We are right in the middle, like Pastor Dan said, this is December. This is Palm Sunday coming up, and then Easter. And, it's a time when people study. Wasn't that an amazing thing on Palm Sunday? One day they're saying, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And next day they're saying, crucify him, crucify him. How many of you know people are really fickle? You can't trust in people. You have to trust in God. But, studying and reading about the time in the Garden of Gethsemane, and then the trial of Jesus and his crucifixion, and then on Easter Sunday celebrating the resurrection. We need to understand, we need to always remember that Christianity was really very integrally and inextricably connected to pain. Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 3 in the New Living says that Jesus was despised and rejected. despised and rejected. How many of you have ever felt despised? How many of you have ever felt rejected? Jesus was despised and rejected, and the Bible says he was. Now, this is written about him 750 years before he showed up, but this is prophecy that he fulfilled. He was despised and rejected. He was a man of sorrows. And that word sorrow there means pain of any kind. Whatever kind of pain you've experienced in life, I want you to know Jesus has been there, done that, and overcome it. He was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief. We turned our backs on him, and he was despised. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised, and we did not care. Now, when you think about Jesus being a man of sorrows, a man who experienced pain, we might say, of any kind, of every kind, what most comes to mind when we think about Jesus and pain? What's the number one thing that comes to our mind when we think of that? The cross. We think of Jesus dying on the cross. And I know that's something you're going to be hearing about over the next days. You're going to be reminded of that. They're going to be showing movies on television about Jesus dying on the cross. And you know, to even try to understand the physical dimension of Jesus' pain is almost beyond comprehension. But then you add on to that whatever was involved in him bearing the sin of the world as he died for us physically, as he shed his blood physically. But in addition to what Jesus experienced on the cross, have you ever stopped to think about the pain that he went through in other parts of his life? The pain that he experienced, for example, at some point, and we don't know where, but we know that Jesus came. He was God the Son, manifested in the flesh, eternally co-equal and co-eternal with the Father and the Spirit. Yet in the incarnation, Jesus took upon flesh, and the Bible tells us in Philippians 2 that he laid aside the privileges. He never ceased being God, but he laid aside the privileges of deity and lived as a man. Jesus was fully God and fully man, except we need to understand that when he was here on this earth, he willingly restricted himself to human experience. And that's why the one who had been eternally omniscient all of a sudden now begins to grow in wisdom and grow in knowledge. There was a time in Jesus' childhood, probably, where how many of you moms, dads, have had one of your little kids maybe see a picture from the hospital when they were born and they want to say, "Mommy, tell me about when I was born." Your kids sometimes are curious about that kind of thing. And some point, you know, Jesus learned that his birth was a really special, unique, spectacular event. I mean, not many kids hear about angelic visitations and wise men showing up with, you know, wonderful gifts and shepherds coming and bowing down. But at some point, not only did Jesus learn about the shepherds and the angels and the wise men, but at some point, Jesus had to learn about the assassination squads, the soldiers that came to kill him. And what's that like for a child to learn that when you were a child, maybe 20 other kids got killed, got murdered senselessly, because a wicked king wanted you dead? I don't know what that would be like, but Jesus had to, as a human, he had to come to terms with, there was a contract on his life as an infant. An evil king wanted him dead, and his mom and dad not only bring him into this world in the way that they did in obedience to God, his true father, but his earthly dad and his mother had to take him and flee to another country, and they lived in exile as refugees. You know, Jesus, I don't know if there's pain associated with that or not, but, I think it'd mess with you to find out that, 20 kids died because a king was trying to kill you. As Jesus moved into adulthood, and especially as he entered ministry, he was a very, very misunderstood person. His own family didn't believe in him when he was preaching. As a matter of fact, at one point, it's in Mark chapter 3, verse 21, it says, when his family heard what was happening, they tried to take him away. And you know what it means when your family tries to take you away? His family tried to take him away. He's out of his mind, they said. They thought he was crazy. In John 7:5, it says, even his brothers did not believe in him. Anybody here come out of a dysfunctional family? Anybody here, when you got saved, they wanted to take you away? They didn't believe, Jesus dealt with that with his own family. Jesus faced rejection like no other human being has ever faced rejection. The Bible says he came to his own, and his own did not receive him. Not only was Jesus rejected, but he was maligned. He was called blasphemer. He was considered to be a heretic of the worst kind. He lived under constant threat of death. People were always talking about and even attempting to kill him. And then Jesus, not only did he experience the pain of rejection and things of that nature, but Jesus also felt deeply the pain of other people. He wept at the tomb of Lazarus. He wept over the city of Jerusalem because he knew that they were destined for destruction because of their rejection of him. Jesus, his own cousin, how many of you have had a relatively senselessly murdered? Jesus' own cousin, John the Baptist, John was his second cousin, was executed by an evil king by beheading. And the Bible says when Jesus heard about the death of his second cousin, John the Baptist, that Jesus went out to be alone in a private place. He just, it hurt him. Jesus was human in every way, shape, and form. And the only thing is that he was without sin. But he was 100% human, and he felt these things profoundly. He felt these things deeply. Jesus was not a robot. And then there's an amazing verse when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane. As you kind of follow the events of Palm Sunday, or sometimes it's called Passion Sunday, the Sunday that kind of opens the gateway into the week that culminated in Jesus' death on the cross. One of the most amazing moments of that week is in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus was not on the cross yet, but he was getting ready to go to the cross. And he wasn't feeling the pain of the crucifixion yet, but there was an anticipatory pain, a dread, and a spiritual and an emotional dread of going to the cross and what it was going to be like, because he knew that not only physically was he going to be, dying and bearing the sin of the world, but something was going to happen that he was going to cry out, my God, why have you forsaken me? I mean, Jesus knew pain. And the anticipatory dread of Calvary, that Jesus experienced in the Garden of Gethsemane was so intense. I want you to look at this in the Amplified Bible. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 37, it says, And taking with him Peter and James and John, the two sons of Zebedee, he, Jesus, began to show grief and distress of mind and was deeply depressed. Then he said to them, "My soul is very sad and deeply grieved, so that I am almost dying of sorrow." I don't know about you, but I look at that and I think, Jesus, what did you go through? What was it like when you spread your arms and you had the nails pierce your hand and you died on the cross for me? You were taking my sin, my shame, my guilt, my punishment, and it was real in every sense of reality. And not only was it horrible on the cross, but even leading up to the cross, the dread and the anticipation, it talks about him being very sad, intense grief, being deeply depressed. I want you to know Jesus has faced whatever you and I face. Jesus has faced it. He not only went through things in his own life, you know, that he experientially faced in terms of pain, but then on the cross as our substitute, then he really took all of the pain of all of humanity upon himself in those hours upon the cross. And that's why we read in the book of Hebrews, there's an amazing summation of this, Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 15, because not only is Jesus our Savior, not only did he die for our sins so we could be forgiven and be the children of God and go to heaven when we die, but the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, it says, "We do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin." Jesus was tempted, tested, and tried. Whatever affliction you've been through in life, whatever attack you've been through in life, whatever pressure you've been through in life, whether it's family, whether it's emotional, whether it's physical, whether it's rejection, whether it's abuse, whether it's loneliness, Jesus either experienced that personally and experientially during his life, or he experienced it as our substitute on the cross when all of the pain, all of the grief, all of the shame, everything that hurt humanity was put upon Jesus on the cross. And you know what? He bore it. Do you know why he bore it? So we could be free from it. He bore our sin so we could be free from that sin. He bore the shame, the guilt, anything that could ever be done to us. Jesus bore that so that we could be set free from it. Jesus is not just our Savior, but he's our high priest. And the Bible says he is able to sympathize, to be touched. I like the King James. He is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. So don't ever think, number one, don't ever think that God is the author of your problems. God is the author of our solution. God is not the author of the pain in your life. God is the author of the cure, the antidote, the health, the healing. Everything was put on him so that we could be free. Now, what we see happening as a result of that, we have a Savior today who understands. Don't ever think that he's the source of the problem, and don't ever think that he doesn't understand. He's not overcome by the feelings of our infirmities, but he is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. We're just going to look at a couple verses in closing. Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1. It talks about, this is again Isaiah, hundreds of years before Jesus came. The Bible says that he came, Isaiah 61, 3, to console. That means to comfort, to console those who mourn in Zion, to give them what? beauty for ashes. Man, have you ever felt like your life had just been reduced to ashes? I mean, it just seemed like you'd been, you know, fried to a crisp by the pressures of life. You just feel like you're a pile of ashes. Jesus came to give us beauty for ashes. He came to give us the oil of joy for mourning, M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G. He came to give us the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. I'll tell you what, Jesus understands the problems and He understands the solution. He took all the ashes upon Himself. He took the mourning upon Himself. He took the spirit of heaviness upon Himself so that He could give us beauty and the oil of joy and the garment of praise. We're a blessed people. Doesn't mean we don't go through some of the stuff. Doesn't mean we don't face some of the junk. But it means we have a Savior who's already been through it, who's already conquered it, who's already risen from the dead, who's already paid the price for us so that we can come out on the winning side when it's all said and done. Jesus said this in Luke chapter 4, verse 18. This is Jesus Himself. Now, He's quoting something from back in Isaiah, but He's personalizing it about Himself. He says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor." Man, if you're poor in any way, shape, or form, poor in spirit, poor in strength, poor financially, Jesus said, "I came to say good news. I came to proclaim good news to you." And He said, "He sent me to heal the brokenhearted. He sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind and to set at liberty those who are oppressed." I don't know how anybody can read the Bible and come up with the idea that God is putting junk and garbage and pain and affliction on people. And Jesus came to do just the opposite. He came to heal, to deliver, and to set free. And that one final verse, this is the last verse we're going to look at tonight. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 33. It says, "By faith..." Hebrews 11 is that great chapter of all these great people of faith. "By faith, these people overthrew kingdoms. They ruled with justice. They received what God had promised them. They shut the mouths of lions. They quenched the flames of fire." I'll tell you, faith will turn you into a Superman. Faith will enable you, trusting God will enable you to see God do exceeding abundantly above all that you could ask or think. And it says, "They quenched the flames of fire and they escaped death by the edge of the sword." Now look at this next part. We've got this up on the screen here. "Their weakness was turned to strength." They became strong in battle and put whole armies to flight. See, so many times when Christians go through weakness, they get intimidated. The devil tells them, "You're not as strong as other people. You're weak. You're worth less than others because of this in your background or this in your present. You aren't as good as other people." And he tries to put all that condemnation and failure and negativity and pessimism into your life to just get you to the place where you're weighed down with oppression. And they put, their weakness was turned to strength. We're talking about transforming your pain into purpose. We're talking about not being ashamed of your challenges and hiding from God because you're afraid you're inferior, but I'm talking about surrendering your weakest areas to God and inviting Him to come in and empower you and energize you and bring such a level of restoration and healing into your life that you not only experience His wholeness, but that you actually then become an agent of ministering that same wholeness to others. And you're able to come alongside other people that are hurting and you're able to say, look, man, I know what it is. See, church is not an issue of acting like we've got it all together. We've always had it all together. You know what? Without Jesus, we were all headed to hell. Our lives were a mess. We needed Jesus. And so we're not proud of ourselves. We are thankful to Him because He's the one that helped us get the pieces put back together again. He's the one that helped restore wholeness. And according to the Apostle Paul, if we want to be people who transform pain into purpose, then we have to say with Paul, God is the one who comforts me in all of my tribulation so that I may be able to comfort others who are in any trouble with the same comfort with which God has comforted me. Freely I have received, freely give. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank You for Your people tonight. And Lord, thank You for the good Word of God. Lord, thank You. I pray for people all over this place. There may be people who are hurting tonight because they've got a child that's, they're concerned about. They have a relationship that is struggling, maybe shattered. Father, there may be people that are struggling emotionally. But Father, I thank You that when we are weak, You are strong. That we don't have to be ashamed when we face and encounter weakness in our life. But Lord, we can come to You, the God of all grace, and You help us. And You pour in that oil, and You pour in that wine, and You soothe, and You comfort, and You console, and You bring wholeness and healing into our life. And Father, I pray for that healing in every person's life tonight. That wherever they're hurting, wherever there's pain, that Father, You'll minister hope to them, life to them, give them grace to endure and to persevere through and not to settle down in the midst of that pain, but to keep walking, keep putting one foot in front of the other, keep believing there's a better day, a brighter day, and Father, to come out because of Your grace. And then, Father, not only am I asking You to bring that kind of healing into every area of their life, but then, Father, I'm asking You to make them an agent of Your healing. The healing comfort that they receive is not to just reside within them, but it's to flow through them. So having received Your healing and comfort, Father, I thank You that they're going to be agents of healing and encouragement to others. Hey, before we go, maybe there's some people here tonight that, we're getting a step beyond you because you have never made Jesus the Lord of your life. You know, the greatest encounter we can ever have is not just getting over an emotional challenge or, some kind of relational challenge with somebody else. The greatest event that can ever happen in our life is when we surrender our lives to God and give our lives entirely to Jesus Christ. If you're here tonight and you don't know God, you don't have a relationship with Him, maybe you're like I was at one time where mentally I believed in God. But if you said, Tony, if your heart was to stop tonight and you were to pass from this life, do you know for sure, do you know absolutely certainly that you would go to heaven? At that time, when I was younger, there was a time in my life where my answer, you know what it would have been? Well, I hope so. I hope so. And the reason I didn't know so is because even though I said I believed in God, even though I said I believed in Jesus, in reality, I was trusting in myself. I was hoping that I was good enough to make it into heaven. I was hoping that I was religious enough. And thank God somebody loved me enough to tell me, Tony, you will never be good enough to make it into heaven. You'll never be perfect enough. You'll never be religious enough. Because heaven is not for good people, perfect people, or religious people. Heaven is for one type of person and one type of person only, and that is a forgiven person. And you can't earn that, you can't deserve that, you can't be good enough, you can't sign your name on enough church membership cards to get forgiven. Forgiveness comes because Jesus Christ died on the cross and shed His blood, and we receive His gift of forgiveness by faith, by putting our trust and our confidence in Him. There may be people here tonight, you've never accepted Jesus as your Savior. And I'm talking to you tonight if that's you. This is your night to not play games. This is your night to say, Jesus, you died for me. I'm going to accept you tonight. Or maybe you're here tonight and you'd say, well, Tony, I accepted God a long time ago, but man, I've been running away from God. I'm like the prodigal son. I've been radically away from God, and I need to rededicate my life. I need to quit running away from God, and tonight I need to come back to God. If that's you, we're going to have a time just to pray with you here. I'm going to ask you to do three things in just a second. In just a second, I'm going to ask if that's you, you've never accepted Jesus, or you've been running away from God and you need to come back. I'm going to ask you to do three things. I'm going to count to three in a minute. I'm going to ask you to raise your hand if that's you. Let me know, Tony, I need to get with God tonight. I need to get saved, get forgiven. Come to God. I need to come back to God. Or if on any of those, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. Let me see your hand. And then I'm going to ask you to stand up when I ask everybody to stand up. And then I'm going to ask you to just come right down here and let me just say a quick word of prayer with you. And tonight's going to be a life-changing night for you. On the count of three, if you've never accepted Jesus or you need to rededicate your life to God, on the count of three, let me see your hand. One, two, three. Let me see your hand. If you need Jesus for the first time, you need to rededicate your life to God. Thank you. I have an usher pointing over here. Thank you. There's three individuals back there. Awesome. Are there others all over this place that with uplifted hands, you're going to come with them and we're going to pray here in just a minute? Are there others? I'm looking all over the place. You need, I might see a hand there. Thank you. I see your hand right there on the edge. That's about five people or so. I see something moving back there. Is that you? Are you fanning or waving? We'll count you as a half. We'll see if you come down. Then I'll know if you were fanning or raising your hand. Hey, let's all stand up. If you raised your hand or should have raised your hand, I want you to slip out of where you are right now. Come meet me right here. Come from the very back. Come from the aisle. Come from the side over here. And let's pray. Let's see some people connect with God tonight. How are you doing? I'm so glad you've come.
Thank you.
God bless you. How are you doing, sir? He is a good father, isn't he? Come right up front, right here, if that's you. Here comes someone. How are you doing? Good to see you. God bless you. God bless you. Hey, in just a minute, do you guys still give people Bibles and stuff? Do you give them all that? In just a minute, this church is going to give you some really nice things to just help you in your spiritual walk. And this guy right here, he's an awesome guy because his name is Tony. So he has to be an awesome guy because that's my name too. But seriously, what we're going to do right now is really important. We're going to pray right here. And everybody is so excited for you because this is an amazing moment in your life. And I'm gonna lead us right here in a prayer. And they're all going to pray along with us because they're involved in this too. But I just want you to like lift a hand up to heaven because that, you know, we're just symbolically, God's up there. You're not looking to me or any person here. We're looking up to heaven. And thank you. Come right on up too. Lift your hand up to heaven and from your heart, say this with your mouth. Say, dear God, I come to you right now. And I thank you that you love me so much that you sent Jesus to die for me. I believe that the blood Jesus shed was sufficient for my forgiveness. And Jesus, I receive you right now with all of your forgiveness and all of your mercy. And not only do I receive you, but I'm giving myself to you. I'm giving you all of my life and all of my heart. And Jesus, you said, whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. So I've come to you and you've taken me in. I'm yours. I belong to you. Help me to live for you and to serve you and to glorify you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you guys turn right over here? And if you'll follow Tony, he's going to take you, give you those Bibles, and God bless you, give you those fun things. And isn't that great to see folks give their hearts to God? And you can go ahead.